Hello, and welcome to the WVSOM Human Gift Registry Memorial Service honoring our 2021 donors. I am Dr. Jacob Newman, Director of the Human Gift Registry here at the West Virginia School of Osteopathic Medicine. And on behalf of all of us in the Human Gift Registry, we are truly honored to be part of this program. This memorial service is to honor the selfless act that your loved one has made to the education of our medical students. Their invaluable gift is something that we truly cherish, and while we do not know your loved ones like you do, their compassion and kindness are clearly evident. We would also like to say thank you to you, because this gift was not only made by your loved one, but often yours as well. Together with you today, we share the pain of your loss, your goodbye, and we celebrate the journey of those you have loved. In a time of loss and grief, you entrusted us. Please know that we are profoundly honored, grateful, and humbled by that decision. Our students come to WVSOM to gain the knowledge and skills they need to become osteopathic physicians in order to care for the mind, the body, and the spirit of their future patients. With this gift, our students are able to develop a greater understanding of the human body through the power of touch. Their development as competent physicians and their growth as compassionate physicians begins with your loved one's gift. They will use the knowledge they have acquired to better diagnose and care not only for you and your families, but the people of West Virginia and the nation. And when there can be no more healing, they will be at the bedside to comfort. During this service, you will hear memories that you have shared of your loved ones and directly from our medical students on how they have been impacted by this gift.
Hello, I'm Sharon Howard, a local licensed pastor with the West Virginia Conference of the United Methodist Churches. WVSOM's website states, "The donation of your body for medical education and research is a compassionate and humanitarian decision. The benefits to mankind are beyond measure. After death, the body can become a gift of life given to others either through the formal medical training of health care professionals in the detailed study of anatomy or to be utilized by research scientists for new discovery." As I read this statement, the word gift stood out to me. A gift is something that one gives with no expectation of anything in return. Each person that we remember today has made such a gift. They have made an ethical and lasting legacy from their life. We have come here today to remember these lives, and it is good to remember. Our memories warm us in moments of loneliness, and our memories help us in time of decisions. The memories of your loved ones have not been taken away with their passing, but have been enhanced because of their kind and giving spirits. Because of the gift which they chose to give at the end of their lives, other individuals have opportunities which would normally not be available. Some of you here today can probably say that some of the good in your life is because of the loved ones whose lives we honor today. Memories can and should be a great source of joy. Memories can bring comfort in times of grief. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. We offer thanks today in this setting. We are here to show support, love, gratitude, and compassion for the gift that your loved one has given. I retired from WVSOM in 2017. I have seen the quality education that our students have received thanks to the generous gifts presented to WVSOM. I leave you with these promises from the song Hymn of Promise. In the bulb there is a flower, in the seed an apple tree, in cocoons a hidden promise, butterflies will soon be free. In the cold and snow of winter, there's a spring that waits to be. There's a song in every silence, seeking word and melody. There's a dawn in every darkness, bringing hope to you and me. From the past will come the future, and what it holds, a mystery. Grant us the strength and courage to embrace our faith so that we may see that all life is truly immeasurable. Amen.
Hello, I am Second Lieutenant Victor Lawani, and I am the current treasurer of the Association of Military Osteopathic Physicians and Surgeons chapter here at WVSOM. We are immensely grateful for the veterans and donors who helped provide us with the gift of medical education. The military interconnects us, creating lasting dynamics and bonds, and establishing a sense of family for all of those who are involved. Service lasts a lifetime, and the impacts continue for even longer. These commitments to service help to ensure the growth of generations of brothers and sisters in arms. These influential veterans went above and beyond the call of duty, sacrificing everything to grow our future military physicians. We want to honor these amazing individuals practicing medicine and utilizing the abundance of skills and knowledge to serve our communities and honor those who came before us. We couldn't be more appreciative of all of your service. Thank you for your service.
Hello, my name is Hannah Ankrum, and I'm a first-year student here at WVSOM. I'm honored to read a tribute dedicated to Miss Elizabeth Blatt, submitted by her children, David, Jennifer, and Allison. Elizabeth K. Blatt, 84, of Athens, West Virginia, died Friday, September 24th of 2021. She was born December 2nd, 1936, in Towson, Maryland, to George Wesley Kempsky and Mildred Quinson Kempsky, and grew up with her sister Dorothy on a parcel remaining from the Kempsky family farm, where she had a goat cart and a cat named Booby Snodgrass. Elizabeth left Towson High School after her sophomore year to enroll in Goucher College on a Ford Foundation scholarship. She earned a bachelor's degree in biology, followed by a master's degree from Vassar College. Elizabeth married her husband, Jeremiah Blatt, in 1958 while she was working as a lab technician at Mount Holyoke College, where he taught. The couple moved to Manhattan, Kansas, where their three children were born, and later to Annapolis, Maryland. In 1967, the family moved to Athens, West Virginia, where Elizabeth and Jeremiah taught at Concord College, now University. In 1971, Elizabeth became the first woman to earn a PhD from Union College, conducting early research on melatonin and being elected to Sigma Xi Scientific Research Honor Society. Her children, who were acknowledged in her published dissertation as dealing with a distracted mother, with grace mostly, remember seeing her hunkered down with yellow legal pads and starlight mints. After graduation, the Blatts drove across the country in their Volkswagen bus so she could do postgraduate work at the University of California at Davis. A major chapter in Elizabeth's professional life began the following year when she joined the founding faculty of Greenbrier College of Osteopathic Medicine, now West Virginia School of Osteopathic Medicine, in Lewisburg. She was hired as a consultant by the school's first president, Dr. Roland P. Sharp, and joined a grant writing committee to keep the new enterprise afloat. When classes began in 1974, Elizabeth became Associate Professor of Physiology and a few years later was named Associate Dean for Preclinical Sciences. Once she returned to West Virginia, Elizabeth was appointed to the West Virginia Board of Osteopathy by Governor Joe Manchin in 2005. The school established the Elizabeth Blatt Prize for the top graduate in each year's class, and in 2010, named her Professor Emerita. In 1984, Elizabeth left West Virginia to spend several years as academic dean at Lake Erie College in Painesville, Ohio, before becoming deputy director of the Science Museum of Virginia in Richmond, where she collaborated with the Medical College of Virginia to create Mini Med School, a 10-week series of lectures about the brain, the immune system, microbiology, biochemistry, genetics, and health policy. Many of the same topics covered by medical students in their first 2 years of training. While in Richmond, Elizabeth embarked on scientific research vacations to Madagascar to work on a census of lemurs and to Peru to catalog bird lice, on an excursion led by her friend Bob DeGleish, who named a species discovered on the trip Mercidia blattae. After she retired from science education in 1998, Elizabeth moved back to Athens, where she enthusiastically resumed her childhood passion for the violin. She took lessons, played chamber music with her friends, enjoyed attending fiddle camp and concerts at Garth Newell Music Center, and was thrilled by a trip to Prague with Chamber Music Holidays. Elizabeth was a supporter of Heartstrings Academy in Carnegie Hall in Lewisburg, serving on the latter's board of directors and hosting a concert there in honor of her 70th birthday. Elizabeth was a voracious reader, especially of mysteries, biographies, and political memoirs. She enjoyed watching Rachel Maddow and Columbo reruns and relished good conversation with her friends over homemade soup or at Moe's restaurant, or with her family over her famous breakfast casserole or wonderful meatloaf. She also had a knack for bread baking. Her whole wheat bread won a blue ribbon at the State Fair of West Virginia. Elizabeth was predeceased by her parents, husband, and sister and brother-in-law, Dorothy and Michael Ewart. She's survived by her children, David and his wife, Renee Reese of Hartford, Connecticut, Jennifer of Phoenix, Arizona, and Allison of Allentown, Pennsylvania. Her granddaughters, Carmen Reese Blatt of Portland, Oregon, and Lorraine Reese Blatt of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Her cousin, Charlotte Evans Knoll of Baltimore, Maryland, and her familiar, Thomas Jefferson Catt.
My name is Delaney Ellis. I'm a first year at WVSOM, and it is with great honor that I get to read the tribute for Michael Lee Bonds that was submitted by his wife, Dreama Bonds. I would like to say thank you to the family for the donation, and if I may speak for the entire student body, acknowledge the greatness of this gift that we are so thankful to receive. Matthew 11:28. Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. After a month of constant hospital visits, Mike passed peacefully at 12:35 a.m. July 19, 2021 in hospice at CAMC Memorial. Born July 12, 1955 at Raleigh General Hospital in Beckley, West Virginia, to Sidney Johnson Bonds and Willie Marie Underwood Bonds, Mike was the youngest of seven siblings. He was preceded in death by his parents, his sisters Frances Marie Farley and her partner Diddy, Sylvia Sidney Nide and her partner Butchie, sister Juanita Howerton, and brother Sonny. Mike is survived by his wife of 24 years, Dreama, his son Michael Lee Bonds Jr., and sisters Peggy and her partner Jude Meadows of Epperly Hill, and Nancy and her husband Gary Soltz of Richmond, Virginia. Mike graduated from Sophia High School. He recently became a member of the Oak Hill United Methodist Church in Oak Hill. Mike served as a trustee of the Eagles Club in Mabscott, West Virginia. He was previously employed with Ranger Fuel in Pittston Coal Mines. He was very proud to be a member of the UMWA Beckley District No. 17 and faithfully attended the union meetings. He was a dedicated member of the Sophia VFW and participated with the military rights group assisting with the funeral of many veterans. Mike loved life and enjoyed his many friends and family. His zest for life will be missed by his family and those who were blessed to know him. He never met a stranger and was kind to everyone he met and knew. It was his wish that his body be used for teaching at the osteopathic school in Lewisburg, West Virginia.
Hi, my name is Joy Brooks and I'm a first year osteopathic medical student. I am reading a tribute honoring Janet Creamer, submitted lovingly by her daughters, Candace Smith and Carrie Caper. Mom, Grandma, Mimi, Great-Grandma Creamer, our family matriarch, she was one of a kind. She loved her heavenly father, Red Lobster, Charlestown races, slot machines, Jeopardy, crab legs, her two daughters and their husbands, Tom Selleck, Engelbert Humperdinck, Tom Jones, and Elvis Presley. Old movies, fried chicken, butter pecan, and chocolate marshmallow ice cream. Christmas morning and watching everyone open the carefully selected presents she purchased. Playing canasta, shopping, getting new clothes, her six beautiful grandchildren and their spouses. She loved naps, tomato sandwiches, the Andy Griffith Show, sweet corn, planning birthday parties for her babies with their favorite foods and cakes, going on drives, singing little songs to us when we were little, then singing those same songs to our children. She loved Wheel of Fortune, her favorite movie of all time, Gone with the Wind. She loved dancing in her younger years, wearing high heels, which she told us she hoped she can wear again in heaven, fancy jewelry, sparkly things, and diamond rings. White diamonds perfume, her eight adorable great-grandchildren whom she looked at pictures of over and over on Facebook. She loved playing Scrabble, but not if you challenged her words. Living with her daughter for the past 14 years, even though moving from her home was very difficult, she loved our father with her whole heart. Driving her car, bird watching, girls' trips with her friends, fixing big Sunday family dinners for all of us, her garden in the backyard, her flowers she planted each year, her bunny collection, and holding babies. As a matter of fact, when I asked her what she thought her job in heaven would be, without hesitation, she said, holding the babies. You see, our mother was so much more than our mother, but she always put us and our needs first. We love you so much, Mom, and we will miss you more than you will ever know. We thank God for you, and we are thankful you are resting in Jesus' loving arm. A poem by Helen Steiner Rice. Time cannot destroy memory, and years can never erase the tenderness and the beauty of the love in a mother's face. When we think of our mothers, we draw nearer to God above, for only God and His greatness could fashion a mother's love.
Hello, my name is Lauren Brown. I'm with the class of 2025. Today, I'm honored to read a tribute for Elizabeth Davis, submitted by her daughter, Jacqueline Perry. Elizabeth Davis was a very creative and generous person. She once had a craft shop where she sold supplies and some of her own creations. She actually gave most of the stuff away to people who would come in and to her children and grandchildren. She loved to create jewelry and also crocheting and knitting. She made crocheted blankets for many of her great-grandchildren. She loved to read and was knowledgeable about many different things. She especially enjoyed reading murder mysteries. She instilled a love of reading in both of her children.
My name is Katie Metersball. I'm a first-year student representing the class of 2025. I have the privilege of honoring Miss Patricia Dempsey in a tribute written by her son, Robbie. Mom, I never had a chance to say goodbye. I miss you so much. I miss our long talks on the phone. I just wish someone would have tried to get a hold of me. I could have made it down to say goodbye. Love forever, your son, Robbie. Also, in honor of Miss Dempsey, I will read the following poem, Memories by Louise Bailey. I feel a warmth around me, like your presence is so near, and I close my eyes to visualize your face when you were here. I endure the times we spent together, and they're locked inside my heart. As long as I have those memories, we will never be apart. Even though we cannot speak anymore, my voice is always there, because every night before I sleep, I have you in my prayer.
Hello, my name is Natalie Fabrizio, osteopathic medical student year one, and I have the privilege to read a tribute honoring Mr. Johnny Dixon, submitted lovingly by his wife, Ms. Sally Dixon. Johnny was born in Mobile, Alabama, and was second oldest of eight children. He grew up in Camden, New Jersey, and graduated from Camden High School in 1957, where he met his first wife and became a father for the first time. After graduating high school, he briefly served in the United States Navy. Johnny attended Temple University, where he met Sidney Jones. They married on June 15, 1961, and during their 16-year marriage became parents to four children, the apples of his eyes. To support his family, Johnny entered the meat industry, which he worked in for most of his life. He started out as an apprentice and worked his way up to meat manager. Johnny was an entrepreneur and at one time owned an independent seafood counter. He loved hunting and fishing, and while in upstate New York, he was sought after by the local farmers for his expertise as a butcher. Not only would he expertly carve the carcasses, he also developed and cased his own sausages. After suffering a stroke in 1994, Johnny moved to West Virginia and was embraced by the community there. He was a man's man, distinguished and honorable, and was always dressed to the nines. He was an excellent provider and hard worker. In fact, he loved working so much that he didn't stop until his health no longer permitted it. Johnny loved the written and spoken word and became a published author of two short story books. He loved gardening, photography, nature, and his little dog, Dexter, who was his faithful companion until the end. He would grow his own fruits and vegetables, which we enjoyed with his excellent culinary skills. He was a skilled chess player with witty and sarcastic humor accompanying his many wins. After much searching, he finally found his soulmate, Sally, and devoted 34 years to loving her until dementia and death parted them. Johnny was devoted to his children, his wife, and his faith. Before his passing, Johnny was joyfully reunited with his oldest child. He is now with his deceased daughter, Christina, Tina, his parents and brothers. Johnny is survived by his devoted wife, Sally, his children, John, Jem, Tamara, Tammy, and Cheryl from his marriage to Sydney, and Dory, Dee, from his first marriage. He is also survived by 11 grandchildren and four great-grandchildren. I would also like to read the following poem in honor of Mr. Dixon. Dad, we thought of you with love today, but that is nothing new. We thought about you yesterday and days before that too. We think of you in silence. We often speak your name. Now all I have are memories and your picture in a frame. Your memory is our keepsake with which we'll never part. God has you in his keeping. We have you in our heart.
Hello, My name is Jillian Gaunt, and I am a first-year medical student. In honor of Miss Anna Douglas, I am reading a poem entitled, I Miss You, Mom, submitted lovingly by her daughter, Sherry Schilling. I miss you, Mom. I thought of you with love today, but that is nothing new. I thought about you yesterday, and the days before that, too. I think of you in silence. I often speak your name. All I have are memories and your picture in a frame. Your memory is my keepsake, with which I'll never part. God has you in his keeping. I have you in my heart.
Hello, I'm Porter Green, a first-year medical student here at WVSOM. I'm grateful to have the privilege of sharing a tribute and poem lovingly submitted by the Dransfield family in honor of Mr. R.B. Glenn Dransfield, Jr. R.B. Glenn Dransfield, Jr. died on June 20th, 2021 at his home in Union, West Virginia after his battle with lymphoma. He was born February 2nd, 1933 in Oceania, West Virginia, and was the son of R.B. Glenn and Dixie Dransfield. As requested, R.B. had his body donated to WVSOM for the purpose of health and medical science education and research. R.B. is survived by his wife of 69 years, Betty, a daughter, Leslie D. Bowers, a son, Jeffrey G. Dransfield, and daughter, Julia D. Martinelli. He had five grandchildren, five great-grandchildren, four step-grandchildren, and one step-great-grandchild. R.B. is also survived by his sister, Isabel, and Karen. R.B. was a retired dairy farmer and former employee of the Mountaineer Feed Center. He managed the family dairy farm for nearly 30 years. He was an active member of the Union Presbyterian Church, served 4 years with the U.S. Air Force with deployment to Korea for 1 year. He served the Monroe County community in various volunteer roles to include chairman of the Monroe County Board of Health and the county's health center. His leadership helped with the establishment of the county's first health center, and staff who worked with him regarded him as a gentleman and kind to all. Everyone knew he was an avid fan of the West Virginia Mountaineers, James Monroe Mavericks, and the Cincinnati Reds, spending many a day or evening watching or listening to his team's play. And on many occasions, if those Mountaineers were not performing as they should, he had some not-so-kind words for the players or referees. He enjoyed country music, the beautiful West Virginia hills, and traveling around the area during growing season to see how the other farmers were doing with their corn and hay. He was a kind and gentle soul and dearly loved by his family and his community. We miss him every day. Here's the poem that the family submitted. The tide recedes, but leaves behind bright seashells on the sand. The sun goes down, but gentle warmth still lingers on the land. The music stops, and yet it echoes on in sweet refrains. For every joy that passes, something beautiful remains.
It's been almost a year since I got the call. February 11, 7:24 that morning. A month to the day from your 86th birthday. Has it been that long? Has it only been that long? I'm sitting here looking at pictures, thinking, reflecting. How would you want to be remembered? I'm only one voice, and I'm sure I'll leave a lot out, but here goes. 1 Thessalonians 4, 9-12. Now as to the love of the brethren, you have no need for anyone to write to you, for you yourselves are taught by God to love one another. For indeed you do practice it toward all the brethren who are in all Macedonia. But we urge you, brethren, to excel still more and to make it your ambition to lead a quiet life and attend to your own business and to work with your hands just as we commanded you, so that you will walk properly toward outsiders and not be in any need. Thank you for loving well. You show me what it means for a man to love his wife as Christ loves the church. You love me and Holly well. I walk with so many people who have never seen or received the love of a father and have never seen or been blessed with a dad who loved their mom well. Thank you for giving us a home of peace. Thank you for creating a space where we knew we would be received, where we would be safe, where there was trust, where we could experience peace. These are rare commodities. Our house may have been simple, lower middle class, most would say, but our home was rich with the things that really matter. Thank you for loving others well. You taught me what it looks like to love the church, to live out the second great commandment, to love my neighbor. From driving the big green cucumber on frosty Sunday mornings, to puppet shows, to the kids from Rock Branch, from fixing whatever broke, to packing moving trucks, from having people around our table when I'm sure we didn't have much, to having people in our little house to live. You show me what it means to love the brethren and to love my neighbor, and through it all, what it means to love God with the hands and feet of Jesus. Thank you for showing me what a life of integrity looks like. You lived what you said you believed, and you did what you said you would do. You taught me how to work and honor, and the honor and dignity of any person's work. And you probably never realized it, but by the way you worked, the way you spoke about work, and the way you treated others in their work, you taught me to respect and honor everyone and to never measure someone by the value society might place on them based on their work or their so-called socioeconomic status. Thank you for showing me the value of humble simplicity. I never saw you boast. I never saw you look down on people. We all place our faith in something or someone. I saw a simple but yet never simplistic faith placed in Jesus, expressed in simply seeking to follow him in every aspect of life. Pure and simple devotion to Christ, Paul calls it elsewhere. Thank you for showing me what that looks like. Thank you for the blessing of following in the footsteps of a father who followed in the footsteps of Jesus. Thank you for blessing me with the incredible wisdom of simplicity. I hope that some of the pearls of that way of life made their way into my bag and that I will not lose them along the way. Thank you for being all of these things. And thank you for being this man and all the funny, quirky, I don't care if you get it or not ways that you are. This is the last picture I ever took of you. How appropriate. You loved well, you lived with integrity, you impacted us all with your humble simplicity, and you did it all with a unique, funny twist that truly made you the original Cheney.
Each day I'll do, a golden deed by helping those who are in need. My life on earth is but a span, and so I'll do the best I can.
Life's evening sun.
Life's evening.
Life's evening.
Hello, my name is Maddie Marshall, and I'm a first-year student here at WVSOM. I am blessed with the privilege to honor Miss Rosalie Eli with a tribute prepared by her daughter, Miss Rebecca Parks. Rebecca said on every Zoom call she had with her mother during her last few months, Rosalie sang, "Let me lean harder on thee." In December of 1940, Rebecca Rosalie was born to William and Juanita Epler in Parkersburg, West Virginia. She was the only daughter and the oldest of her siblings. Rosalie was an outdoor enthusiast and enjoyed hiking and exploring trails wherever she lived, with one of her favorite locations that she spoke of many times being the Carlsbad Caverns. Rosalie was known as a dedicated Christian who endeavored to be the proverbial woman. She was never too busy to listen, pray, or provide support for those that were in need. A gifted soprano, Rosalie was a member of many choirs, including Sweet Adeline's in Los Angeles and the Greenbrier Valley Chorale in Lewisburg, and had a song for every occasion. One of her favorite activities to do prior to her health declining was going to the local nursing homes and singing hymns to the residents in hopes of brightening their day and ministering to their faith. One of her favorite hymns that encapsulated her love and faith to God was "Let Me Lean Harder on Thee" by E.E. Hewitt. Rosalie was also a talented seamstress and cook who shared this love and talent with her daughter, Rebecca. An avid reader, Rosalie enjoyed studying the Bible, poetry, and holistic health, which led her to donate herself to increase the knowledge of helpers. Rosalie's memory is cherished by her daughter, Rebecca Parks, and her husband, Jonathan, 7 grandchildren, Zachary Beau and Sebastian Bilbo, Felicity Eli, Kirsten, Mallory, and Allison Parks, brothers David and his wife Christine, Paul and his wife Billy, Bruce and his wife Kay, and Richard Epler.
Hello, my name is Michael Masiha. I am a first year at the West Virginia School of Osteopathic Medicine, and I am here today to truly express how meaningful and generous it is to have people that we don't even know aid us in our pursuit of a higher education. The sacrifice, support, and love we feel as medical students truly give us so much to look forward to when it comes the day we get to practice medicine. I would like to now share a reading provided by Michael and Suzanne, Gary and Lene, Jason and Myla for their father, Mr. Ray Ensminger. Many people regard their father as the best dad in the world, but our dad truly was. A genuine self-made man, he and our mother started out with very little, as he endured years of grease-covered fingers and scarred knuckles in a life spent as a mechanic and the stress of managing a business in uncertain times. He always did the best he could and was known for his honesty and personal integrity. Family beach vacations and time spent hunting and fishing with his sons were welcome breaks. Before he lost his hearing, Dad always said that "Raindrops Keep Falling on My Head" was his favorite song. Whether he identified with the song's theme of hardship versus optimism, or he just liked the tune, he didn't say. But one thing is certain, Dad overcame a lot in his life, and met adversity with hard work and sheer determination, and smiled through it all. We love you, Dad, Michael and Suzanne, Gary and Lene, Jason and Myla. Thank you.
Hello, I am Deanna Morrow, a first-year osteopathic medical student, and I am reading a tribute honoring Mr. Paul Greer, lovingly written and submitted by his 3 daughters, Betsy, Paula, and Amy. Paul Greer was born in Mohegan, West Virginia, in 1926, and lived in West Virginia for an impressive 95 years. He was married to Betty for 62 years and had 3 daughters, 4 granddaughters, and 1 great-grandson. He worked as an educator and coach in Wyoming and Greenbrier counties. His passion for science grew through the years. He taught biology, anatomy and physiology, PE, and driver's ed for 39 years, beginning his career at Herndon High School. He then moved his talents to Oceana High School and ended his career at Greenbrier East High School. Ever the biology teacher, he was so very proud when he made the decision to continue teaching young minds, even in death. A number of his students graduated from this very school as doctors of osteopathy. A 1945 graduate of Baileysville High School, a 1948 graduate of Concord College, and a 1963 graduate of University of Missouri, Paul valued his education. A member of the Greatest Generation, he proudly volunteered to serve his country in the Army Air Corps as a World War II scooped up the young men across the country. A bout with rheumatic fever kept him stateside, but his experiences continued his growth as a young man. Sports played an important role when in high school and college as he played basketball at Concord. To many high school students and communities, Paul Greer was coach. In 1949, he began his basketball coaching career at a small gymnasium in Herndon, West Virginia. Coach Greer then moved to the same position with Oceana in 1956. You could say the rest is history. Basketball was his first love in coaching, having completed 17 seasons. He had 5 state tournament appearances, 1 runner-up, and 2 state champions. In 1965, he compiled an impressive, undefeated 26-0 season. Add to that a state championship in track and field, pulling off that feat with only 5 athletes. A West Virginia sports writer called him the best high school basketball coach in the state of West Virginia, citing his particular coaching emphasis of destructive defense. He left OHS in 1973 to finish his coaching career at Greenbrier East High School. But beyond coaching sports, Coach Greer emphasized helping transition his boys into young men. Some quotes when learning of his passing. "There will never be enough words to truly express the respect and admiration I have for Coach Greer. He is truly a legend among high school basketball coaches. He was tough, but fair. The impact he had on so very many lives is hard to estimate, for he had the unique ability to inspire his students on and off the court. He taught not just about basketball, but discipline I have called upon many times in my life. Respect for others and a resolve to never quit. Coach took an untalented young man with little self-esteem and transformed him into a basketball player. His influence will never be forgotten. Coach taught you the true meaning of respect. It was instilled for you for the rest of your life. My coach, this is the person who took a skinny beanpole and turned him into a basketball player. He gave me the fire to be the best I could be. Coach had the unique ability to take kids and turn them into winners. Coach, you made a difference in so many lives." Coach Greer practiced what he preached when it came to physical fitness. Always an athlete, he began his journey as a youth by batting rocks across a creek near his home with a homemade bat. He continued with an exercise routine until his passing. He was a runner through his middle years and participated in many road races, from 5Ks to the Charleston Distance Run 15-miler. He continued workouts at Greenbrier Valley Fitness, where he inspired and encouraged many friends in their personal workouts. When COVID locked us all down, he exercised at home with weights and walking in the neighborhood. Again, he inspired the passerbys in the neighborhood as he gave a friendly wave. He had the honor and privilege to carry the Olympic torch for the 1996 Atlanta Olympics. He will be missed by loved ones and many friends. Here's to a life well lived.
Hello, my name is Dominic Mutillo, a first-year osteopathic medical student. I'm here to share a memorial of Mr. James Francis Juarez and a poem submitted by his children, Brian, Leanne, and Brent. James Juarez died peacefully on February 23, 2021 at his Charleston, West Virginia home, surrounded by his devoted family. He was 75 years old. The president of Village Construction Company for 45 years, he was also a beloved pottery teacher at Taylor Books. Jim remained an active and involved member of the community for more than 50 years, volunteering his time and a broad range of skills to promote the causes in which he passionately believed. He will be long remembered by so many in West Virginia for his generosity of spirit and commitment to helping others. James Francis Juarez was born on September 22, 1945, in Wheeling to Francis and Catherine Hagen Juarez. A graduate of St. Fidelis Franciscan Seminary, he received a BA from Wheeling Jesuit University and his MBA from the Mendoza College of Business at the University of Notre Dame. Upon his arrival in Charleston in 1969, Jim worked as Managing Director of the Governor's Office of Federal-State Relations State Planning Division. For a period of time, Jim was an instructor at the U.S. Virginia University Institute of Technology. and in 1975 he started Village Construction Company. During the 1980s, Jim served as president of and volunteer at Mana Meal, a local soup kitchen that serves hot lunches. In addition to overseeing its overall management, he was involved in securing financial and food donations. Jim was also the founder and president of the board of directors of the Charleston Men's Emergency Shelter. In addition, he started and volunteered as president of the Shelter Company, a nonprofit organization that built homes for low-income families. In cooperation with the City of Charleston, the West Virginia Housing Development Fund, and local savings and loan company, the Shelter Company arranged affordable mortgages for several 2- and 3-bedroom townhouses in downtown Charleston. The Shelter Company also instructed and trained young people in the carpentry trade. For the past 39 years, Jim had been a board member of the Southern Appalachian Labor School since its inception as a community-based organization. The Shelter Company is now an integral part of SALS. In 1990, Jim attended the University of Georgia's art program in Cortona, Italy, where he honed his pottery skills and studied sculpture and art history. Over the past several years, he loved teaching the pottery classes that he had started in the basement of Taylor Books in downtown Charleston. Jim and his students made hundreds of mugs and dishes for SALS, hospice, and other nonprofit organizations. They were sent out as thank you gifts to donors throughout the country. During the final weeks of Jim's life, he derived great joy from occasional visits to his pottery studio at Taylor Books, where he continued to guide and encourage his students to whom he was so devoted. A poem in honor of James Horace. Desiderata. Go placidly amid the noise and haste, and remember what peace there may be in silence. As far as possible, without surrender, be on good terms with all persons. Speak your truth quietly and clearly, and listen to others. Even the dull and the ignorant, they too have their story. Avoid loud and aggressive persons. They are vexations to the spirit. If you compare yourself with others, you may become vain and bitter, for always there will be greater and lesser persons than yourself. Enjoy your achievements as well as your plans. Keep interested in your own career, however humble. It is a real possession in the changing fortunes of time. Exercise caution in your business affairs, for the world is full of trickery. But let this not blind you to what virtue there is. Many persons strive for high ideals, and everywhere life is full of heroism. Be yourself, especially do not feign affection. Neither be cynical about love, for in the face of all aridity and disenchantment, it is as perennial as the grass. Take kindly the counsel of the years, gracefully surrendering the things of youth. Nurture strength of spirit to shield you in sudden misfortune, but do not distress yourself with dark imaginings. Many fears are born of fatigue and loneliness. Beyond a wholesome discipline, be gentle with yourself. You are a child of the universe. No less than the trees and the stars, you have a right to be here. And whether or not it is clear to you, no doubt the universe is unfolding as it should. Therefore be at peace with God, whatever you conceive him to be. And whatever your labors and aspirations and the noisy confusion of life, keep peace with your soul. With all its sham, drudgery, and broken dreams, it is still a beautiful world. Be cheerful, strive to be happy. Max Ehrman.
Spend all your time waiting for that second chance, for a break that would make it okay. There's always some reason to feel not good enough, and it's hard at the end of the day. I need some distraction. Oh, a beautiful release. A memory sip through my veins. Let me feel empty. Oh, and weightless, and maybe I'll find some peace tonight. In the arms of the angel, fly dark, cold hotel room and the endlessness that you feel. You are pulled from the room. silent reverie. You're in the arms of the angel. May you find some comfort here. So tired of the straight lines, and everywhere you turn, there's vultures and thieves at your back. The storms keep on twisting. You keep building the lies that you make up for all that you lack. It don't make no difference. Escaping one last time, it's easier to believe in this sweet madness. Oh, this glorious sadness that brings me to my knees. You're in the arms of the angel. Fly from this dark, cold hotel room and the endlessness that you feel. You are pulled from the wreckage of your silent reverie. You're in the arms of the angel. Find some comfort here. You're in the arms of the angel. May you find some comfort here. Comfort here.
Hello, I'm Sarah McQueen, a first-year osteopathic medical student here at WVSOM, and I have the privilege of sharing a reflection and poem in honor of Miss Shirley Cashola, submitted by her sister, Retha Hinton. What is a sister? A reflection by Sister Retha Hinton. What is a sister? A sister is someone you've grown up with, spent your whole life knowing, and have shared laughter, pain, secrets about your family that only your family knows. My sister was smart, a unique individual who went her own way, told it like it is, even though she had a way about it that hurt sometimes. She loved nonfiction, but had little use for fiction books, loved animals, loved the oldies and current rock, but despised country music. She did have a sense of humor, loved true stories of the dumbest criminals, and would repeat them often. I will miss her phone calls. She'd hear something funny or outrageous on the radio and would call to tell me. Shirley did her own thing. She did not care what other people thought of her, but if she liked someone, they knew it. She was adventurous, and a lot of people admired her for that. If she wanted to go to another state, she did it, not knowing where or exactly how she was getting there until it happened. She was independent, not wanting help, and that was a problem in her later years after she had a stroke. My sister and I had a lot of arguments. She was my older sister of 3 years, 3 months, and 3 days. We didn't see eye to eye on a lot of things, but we both knew we loved each other, no matter what our differences were, and I will miss her. I love you, your little sister, Retha. Retha Hinton asked her friend, Kathy Belcher, to write a poem about Shirley because Kathy loves to write poetry. The following poem is Kathy's final goodbye to Shirley. Kathy came through for Shirley's family. Retha wishes to thank Kathy. The poem is Shirley Perfectly. Ode to Retha's Sister by Kathy Belcher, with much love. Shirley was rich in uniqueness, with a dash of obliqueness and a hint of secret or two. Her eyes could be disarming, even rather alarming, as though viewing the inside of you. I still can't recall a time when she didn't speak her mind in a matter-of-fact kind of way. On most subjects, she knew bunches and never pulled punches, both to my delight and my dismay. She would catch you by surprise with a twinkle in her eyes, just to see if you had caught her drift. If you did or did not, it mattered not a lot. Either way, she kept her gritty wit. 'Twas on a bright and sunny day, she graced me in her special way, when she picked up her mail with a friend. She'd brought him in to meet me, at the counter he did greet me, and I smiled a smile that had no end. For there he stood before me, in all his blue suede glory, with a look of disdain and protest, first surely reassured him, and then easily lured him into doing a few song requests. Just imagine my surprise and the glint in Shirley's eyes, for she'd brought an Elvis concert to me. He was performing on stage, which meant inside of his birdcage, and no sweeter songs could ever more be. In about 5 minutes or so, I was blessed more than you'd know from this kindness Shirley had planned. She and Elvis became a gift, formed out of a playful mischief, and we three shared a big-eyed time so grand. Oh, what joy and oh, what fun. I just had to tell everyone who entered the post office that day about Elvis Bird, Shirley too, and their thoughtful deed so true that chased my working gal blues away. So here's my herbal tea toast with these things I think of most when remembering Retha's sister. There's just one more thing to say, and that's how very much I pray for God's blessings on all those who miss her.
Hi, I'm Michelle Talman, a first-year medical student, and I will be reading a poem honoring Sue Moody, submitted by her daughter, Paula McCoy. She Is Gone by David Harkins. You can shed tears that she's gone, or you can smile because she has lived. You can close your eyes and pray that she will come back, or you can open your eyes and see all that she has left. Your heart can be empty because you can't see her, or you can be full of the love that you shared. You can turn your back on tomorrow and live yesterday, or you can be happy for tomorrow because of yesterday. You can remember her and only that she is gone, or you can cherish her memory and let it live on. You can cry and close your mind, be empty and turn your back, or you can do what she would want, smile, open your eyes, love, and go on.
Hello, my name is Sarah Socrates and I'm a first year medical student. I am reading a tribute and poem honoring Miss Linda McGraw, submitted lovingly by her family. Linda Carol McGraw, 73, of Hinton, West Virginia, went to join loved ones in heaven on Sunday, June 20th, 2021, following a long illness. Linda was born in Sandstone, West Virginia, on August 16th, 1947. She was the valedictorian of her Sandstone High School class of 1964. She and her husband, Richard Allen McGraw, of Sandstone, were married for 25 years prior to his death in 1989. Linda worked as a bank teller and then a medication technician before staying at home full-time to raise her four children. During her husband's cancer battle, she returned to work as an administrative assistant in the West Virginia State Park System. She earned a Bachelor of Science in Social Work from Concord University in 1997. She was a social worker for the Children with Special Healthcare Needs Program for the WVDHHR until her retirement in 2007. Linda enjoyed traveling and was an award-winning baker and seamstress. She hosted frequent family gatherings over the years where she served up many delicious meals and beat us all in Scrabble. She enjoyed organizing the Williams family reunion for years and was most proud of her four children and three grandchildren. Those preceding Linda in death include husband Richard McGraw, father Hayward Ward, mother Verna Mae Voyers, and brothers Dale and Edwin Ward. Those left to remember her include son Jack McGraw and his wife Veronica of Las Vegas, Nevada, son Stuart McGraw and his wife Priscilla of Hinton, West Virginia, daughter Jamie Hutman and her husband Thomas of Charlotte, North Carolina, son Matthew McGraw and wife Darylyn of Covington, Virginia, grandson Alan McGraw and granddaughters Monica Hutman and Claire McGraw. Linda chose to donate to the West Virginia School of Osteopathic Medicine and will be interred in Cooper Cemetery in Sandstone on a later date. Her children and grandchildren love and miss her and appreciate the opportunity to memorialize Linda's life through WVSOM.
Hello, my name is Dina Muhammad Ali and I'm a first-year student at WVSOM. It is my great privilege to share a tribute in honor of Miss Minnie McMillian, submitted by her children, Amy and Danny Odell. They share the following. Our mom, Minnie Ray McMillian, was born April 7, 1948 at Friars Hill, West Virginia. She was the daughter of the late Samuel and Stella McMillian. She was a member of the Rennick Baptist Church. In addition to her parents, Mom was preceded in death by her sister, Beatrice Haas of Rennick. She is survived by sisters Ann Walker of Hillsboro, Ruby Deal of Lewisburg, and Vicki Haymans of Lewis Creek, sons Daniel and Kenneth, her daughter Amy, 7 grandchildren, and 1 great-grandson. Mom could be feisty and stubborn. She loved collecting glassware, quilting, crocheting, baking, and making candy. Mom enjoyed going to auctions to find treasures to add to her growing collection of stuff. She loved to laugh. Mom was a great cook and was fiercely protective of her family. Mom liked to lend a helping hand when she was able, and her long-standing wish was to help the medical community at WVSOM with her gift. We miss her.
Hello, my name is Hannah Ritter. I'm a first-year medical student, and I'll be sharing 3 poems in honor of Mr. Buford Miller. These poems were selected by his wife, Margie, and son, Craig. The first 2 were written by them. In memory of Buford B. Miller. Your life on earth is over, you're in your heavenly home. It broke our hearts to see you go, but we have peace to know you are not alone. You are with your blessed Savior. Our son Jeffrey and other loved ones gone before. Life will never be the same without you. You were everything to us. We will never forget you. And when God calls our name, we will be reunited again forever. To remain in that beautiful place called heaven, you were our gift from God. We thank God every day for your love, presence, smiles, hugs, guidance, jokes, touch, laughter, and handshakes. Forever in our hearts, a love that can never be replaced. A birthday poem written for Buford's 85th birthday. Happy birthday in heaven with Jeffrey and Logan. I will bake your special cake. We'll sing the birthday song. We'll read your birthday cards to you and open presents all day too. You won't be present in body, but your spirit is always here. PK and WC will hang around to see what they can do, and River is waiting to give a kiss to you. Forrest could not be here but sends a woof to you, and Craig will surprise you with that special gift and card he always gets for you. We'll tell you how much we love you and thank you for all you do. We'll go to bed that night and hope one day we will be joined with you in that blessed place called heaven, forever in our hearts, a love that can never be replaced. One Day at a Time, by author Alice H. Mortensen. One day at a time, let us travel along, often through shadows, but always with song. The song of redemption that rings in our ears, dispelling the darkness and calming our fears. One day at a time, we do not need more than strength for one day, for Christ goes before, marking our pathway with signs of his love, making us ready for mansions above. One day at a time, no sorrow so deep, but can still follow the print of his feet for one single day, and it may be the last ere the journey is ended and finished our task. One day at a time, let us triumph our care and prove the valley that Jesus is there, that others may find him because our lights shine as a witness for Jesus one day at a time.
Hello, my name is Sol Gopal. I'm a first-year osteopathic medical student, and I have the privilege of sharing a tribute in honor of Charles Robert Parkins, submitted by Dr. Grant Parkins. Charles Bob was born November 15, 1944, in a coal camp in Plymouth, West Virginia, to parents Charles Barbie Parkins and Rosalie Ruth Wright Parkins. He was the first in his family to graduate high school, attending Poca High School. Bob attended West Virginia State College, where he served in an ROTC exchange program to Sierra Leone, Africa in 1965. He was active in student government and served as editor of the college newspaper, The Yellow Jacket. He graduated with a BA in history in 1969. Bob trained as a sanitarian after college, relocating to Spencer, West Virginia, where he served both Roane and Calhoun counties in this capacity. He furthered his career by attending University of Charleston and receiving his MS in environmental health, which led him to a career in air quality asbestos testing and environmental assessment, and cleanup of EPA sites in West Virginia and elsewhere. He completed his education by receiving a PhD from Columbia Pacific University and finished his career as a private consultant before retiring. Bob was active in his professional and civic organizations, serving as president for the West Virginia Sanitarians Association, the West Virginia Public Health Association, and the local Rotary Club in Spencer, West Virginia. Through his trip to Africa and hosting Rotary International Exchange students from Australia and the Philippines, his love of travel was born. Bob had a goal to travel to all seven continents, which he completed in 2019 by visiting South America and spending his 75th birthday at Machu Picchu in Peru. He visited Brisbane, Australia, where he was hosted by a former exchange student daughter, Mariel Parker Stanger, and her daughter, Serena. He visited his daughter, Jennifer, in Sitka, Alaska twice, once taking a side trip to Denali State Park to visit America's tallest mountain, and a second time driving across country from West Virginia to Alaska. He noted of all his travels, going to Paris with his son Grant and grandson Alexander was his favorite. While there, they climbed the Eiffel Tower, ate fresh-baked French baguettes, and visited the palace of King Louis XIV at Versailles. He loved visiting his sisters and their families in Texas, always timing it to attend the state fair. Bob also never passed up an opportunity for a good beach trip, staying at all points between Key West, Florida and Atlantic Beach, Maryland. Besides travel, Bob Eagleclaw was active in the recovery community where he helped many people during his 34 years of sobriety. He started a Native American 12-step meeting at the Serenity Club in Dunbar and served there on the board of directors. Bob Eagleclaw was passionate about his Native American lineage and invested time and energy into working with others to preserve its rich heritage in the state of West Virginia. He participated in powwows and published a semi-autobiographical novel about his experience as a Native American called A Prejudiced Resentment. Bob loved his family and being powwow to all his grandchildren. He was often found in the last few years cheering them on at numerous sporting events. He also shared a love of cooking with his daughter, Annalisa. He loved sharing his favorites with friends and family, which always included his famous bread pudding, blackberry cobbler, black forest ham, and smoked pork. His love of gardening and flowers resulted in many hours outdoors and quality time spent with his sister, Patsy, both known for their green thumbs. His life was full and rich, and his passing peaceful. He is greatly missed.
Hi, my name is Jillian Keat. I am a first-year osteopathic medical student, and I will be reading a tribute submitted by Leanne Patton in honor of her mother, Betty Jo Patton. Betty Jo Maddie was born in Flat Top, West Virginia on June 1, 1937. She was the daughter of Fred and Willie Maddie. She attended Shady Spring High School and graduated with honors in 1955. The same year, she married her high school sweetheart, Elmore Lee Patton Jr. from Hinton, West Virginia, and they spent the next 65 years together until her death in 2021. Lee and Betty spent their first 10 years together in Huntington, West Virginia and Northern Ohio before moving back to West Virginia for good. During that time, they had three children, Mark, Leanne, and Don, and were blessed with two grandchildren and four great-grandchildren. After many years in Cross Lanes, West Virginia, they moved to Princeton, then to Bluefield, where they were living when Betty passed away on February 6, 2021. From an early age, Betty loved music, playing the clarinet in the Shady Spring High School band, and singing in the choir where she made all-country band and choir. Betty spent most of her life involved in volunteerism, from being a Cub Scout den mother to working the Little League concession stand, a school helper, working the United Methodist Church food pantry, and everything in between. She was very outgoing and never met a stranger. Her dentist once told her if she didn't stop talking, he was going to charge her double. She had a great sense of humor and passed it on to her children. Our family was always cutting up. When her son Don got a job at the Cross Lanes Foodland as a bag boy in 1980, Betty got the call while Don was in school. She made a little sign she stuck in the downstairs window for him to see, reading, "You got it." Don and his mom used to go to the Ona Mall together and go shopping after a long drive and sharing stories. Usually, 94% of the stories were hers. Eventually, they would go see a matinee together where his mom always wanted to sit in the back. Don would sit closer to the screen, and at the end of the movie, it was a coin toss as to whether she sat through it or not. She could be impatient in that way. Whenever her children achieved something, Betty was always so excited and bragged about us. During the Marshall University Academic Fair, Don was one of the only students whose parents and sister traveled the 41 miles from Cross Lanes to give him support. She wouldn't stop talking about it for years. Betty was a great cook, and she made the best pot roast in all the land. To this day, it is Leanne's favorite meal. We would joke that Russian spies were sent to discover her recipe and technique. Other culinary masterpieces were bologna sandwiches and white bread, the kind that sticks to the roof of your mouth. She made the original whoopie pie and sugar donuts made from deep frying Poppin' Fresh biscuits. Betty loved to go shopping, especially at yard sales, a hobby she passed down to her children. Leanne recalls that she and her mom could be driving anywhere, but if we saw a yard sale sign, all bets were off to get wherever we were going on time. She had a good relationship with her children and spoke to all of them several times a week up until the day she died. Betty was a Christian and a member of Cross Lanes United Methodist Church. Her favorite hymn was "How Great Thou Art." She loved genealogy, and because of her, we have a lot of great stories to pass on. Mark got the bug for family history and passed it down to his children. The donation of her body to WVSOM was her last act of kindness and selflessness. She is dearly missed.
Hi, I'm Michelle Talman, a first-year medical student, and I will be reading a tribute of Stephen Richardson submitted by his daughter-in-law, Tammy Hall Richardson. "They don't make men like my father-in-law anymore. I say this with great certainty. He was a proud veteran, a quiet man who was sure of himself, confident with who he was, and did not look for approval from others. He served the Lord with a giving heart and knew that what God and angels thought of him was all that really mattered. He loved his family fiercely, even me. I met his son and then subsequently him at a time in my life when I had been hurt beyond words and had covered that hurt and anger with a burning drive to become somebody to be proud of and never let anyone close enough to hurt me again. People like me are known as difficult, introverted, closed off. I felt it was easier to live that way. You wouldn't get hurt like that again. Stephen Richardson loved me anyway, and over time, I let my guard down and loved him like a dad. I lost my own father when I was just 14, and after years of longing for that father figure in my life, he took that on and never once complained. It is hard for me to sum up in words who Stephen Richardson was, still is to me, and how the hurt I feel in my heart since he left this world is something I can't describe. He had a sense of humor that showed itself when I needed it. He was secure in who he was. Led a Christian life like God teaches us to. Prayed for favor and grace to surround those he loved. He didn't just pray it, he lived it. He fought cancer bravely, never looking for pity. He remained the proud, strong man he always was until the end. Things have changed so much since he's been gone. I used to ask myself, what would Stephen do in many situations? I could always talk to him, and even though most times he didn't give me the answer, hearing his calm, steady voice helped me come to it on my own. Since he left, at times I feel like that lost 14-year-old kid all over again. Even though he's in heaven, I hope he still knows how much I love him, how much I miss his hugs, his wisdom, how he loved my cream cheese bars, how we both shared a love of everything made by Apple and listening to the newest Adele CD. I will always be proud to say that I'm the daughter-in-law of Stephen Richardson and how blessed I was to have him in my life.
Hello, my name is Claire Scheuer, and I am part of the WVSOM class of 2025. I have the sincere honor of reading a tribute to Mrs. Patricia Robertson, lovingly written by her daughter, Lene Ensminger. Patricia Ann Robertson passed away shortly after midnight on Valentine's Day, 2021, this special day being symbolic of the life she lived. My mother was a loving, caring and generous person to her family, friends, and everyone she met. She had a heart of gold. Mom was hardworking and independent. Unfortunately, she lost that independence the last years of her life due to a medical condition known as Huntington's chorea. She faced this disease with grace and strength, never losing her loving spirit. She remained humble and faithful throughout her walk in this life, and I am forever grateful I had the privilege of being her daughter. I miss you every day, Mom.
Hello, I'm Erin Reese, osteopathic medical student, class of 2025, and I have the privilege of reading the obituary of Mr. Earl Roth, followed by the eulogy shared by his granddaughter, Ashley Bostick Eisenberg. Earl Edward Roth, 88, of Renick, passed away Saturday, November 20th, 2021 at Peyton Hospice House in Fairleigh. Earl was born April 17, 1933 at his grandparents' home, Earl and Maud Spitzer Mosser, near Oakland, Maryland. He was a son of the late Daniel Webster and Virginia Elizabeth Mosser Roth. Earl graduated from Aurora High School and was an honor graduate of West Virginia University in 1961 with a degree in forestry, and was an honorary fraternity member of both Gamma Sigma Delta and Psi Sigma Pi. He served in the United States Air Force as a staff sergeant during the Korean War. He was a self-employed forestry consultant until his retirement after owning Greenbrier Lumber Company. His first job after graduating from college was with Pioneer Lumber Company at Daly, West Virginia, a division of Coastal Lumber Company. He enjoyed hunting, fishing, traveling, and making memories with his family as a husband, father, papa, grandpa, uncle, and brother. His past work in the community included the Greenbrier Valley Airport Authority, Greenbrier Valley Soil Conservation District, Society of American Foresters, and the WVU and Forestry Alumni Associations. He was a member of Clifton Presbyterian Church and the past member of the Redneck Volunteers Fire Department. He was one of the founders of the Northern Greenbrier Emergency Service and an emergency medical technician for over 20 years. Other than his parents, he was preceded in death by a brother, Donald Roth. Survivors include his wife of 66 years, Alice Douglas Roth, children, Larry Earl Roth and his partner, Lisa, Neil Edward Roth and his partner, Marcia, and Lynn Roth Bostick and her partner, David. Granddaughters, Ashley Bostick Eisenberg and her partner Nick, Caitlin Roth, Elizabeth Roth Ford and her partner Jay, and Allison Bostick, great-grandchildren Noah Eisenberg and Poppy Eisenberg, sister Mary Jane Nagy. A celebration of life will be held later in the spring. His body was donated to the West Virginia School of Osteopathic Medicine.
They say grief is unexpressed love. And back in November, I tried my best to express my love to you. We all did. We knew this day would come, but none of us were ready to say goodbye. I can still hear you yelling, "There's my girl," as I would ring the doorbell nonstop until you opened the front door. Or hear you tapping at your spot beside the couch. That spot right there beside you was always reserved for me. I dreaded walking into your home and not seeing you in your chair. The chair I used to sit in when I would convince my mom and mamaw that I was too sick to go to school, and you would let me sit there and eat bean and bacon soup, not at the table. It was a treat. We'd watch TV all day and read the Sunday newspaper cartoons that you saved for me. It's hard to put into words or capture all of our special memories over the years. I'll miss you calling me on my birthday to tell me on this day in 1989 I stopped smoking, or to hear you talk to Poppy over FaceTime. She certainly was stealing the favorite title right away from me with you. I am flooded with our memories, from fishing to beach trips to my first sleepover at Papa and Mamaw's house. I hope I never forget a single moment we shared together. I started saving your voicemails this past year. It was Caitlin's idea, and I'm glad she told me to save them. You were always my first call when I had news to share, good or bad. I always wanted to make you proud. You were one of the good ones, teaching us all the importance of faith, family, and hard work. I still remember calling you to tell you I was going to West Virginia Wesleyan for college. I was ready for the disappointment. Turns out I'd be the only granddaughter not to attend West Virginia University. But all you told me was you were proud of me. I hope we all continue to make you proud. Our last time together, you had Mama drive you down to Mom and Dad's house so you could say goodbye before we went back home. It was Poppy's first trip to West Virginia at only a month old. You didn't have the strength to get out of the car, so Poppy and I joined you in the car while she ate. We both joked that we were still wearing our pajamas late into the afternoon. You just kept telling me how beautiful Poppy was and how proud you were of me. We sat in the car and watched the family chat in the backyard. You asked me when I'd see you again, and I told you Christmas. You weren't too happy with that response, almost as if you knew that you wouldn't be here for the holidays to bless our meals or remind us that you can hear everything with your hearing aids. I promised to continue our weekly FaceTime chats, which you loved. You told me you were getting tired, neither one of us wanting to say goodbye. I held your hand tight as we both, through teary eyes, said, "I love you." And you said, "Goodbye, honey." I'll cherish that August afternoon for the rest of my life, just like I'll always cherish you. I was lucky to get to know you, to have you as my papaw, and to be raised by my knight in shining armor. Mom always loved when you took the credit for raising me. Can hear you chuckling now. Watch over us all and keep visiting Poppy in her dreams. Our perfect little sleeper has been waking up at 4 a.m. ever since November 20th, chatting and laughing. And I just know she's talking to her great papaw, the angel. May you teach her all of life's important lessons, share our family history, never let her forget just how much she is loved. And I hope you two don't mind when I lean over and whisper to the baby monitor, "I love you, papaw."
Hello, my name is Kunal, and I am a first-year osteopathic student at WVSOM. Today, I have the privilege of sharing Carla Casella's tribute for her father, Danny Roy Jr., who went by Buck. Buck had a very quick wit and a wonderful sense of humor, which often brought laughter to those around him. He was stubborn to the core, but yet he was compassionate and gentle. Buck was married to his wife, Darlene, for 55 years. They spend most of their lives together, working through all the experiences marriage and life can bring to a couple, and she was lucky enough to be by his side when the unexpected happened. Throughout Buck's life, his children, Danny, Carla, and Jennifer, knew he was the strongest, hardest working man they knew, and his grandchildren had the pleasure of watching him fix anything that came his way. Nothing was ever really broken. Buck was also a mentor and friend to his son-in-law, Bill. Buck had so many good qualities, he will be greatly missed by his family and friends.
Hi, I'm Michelle Taubman, a first-year medical student, and I will be reading a poem honoring Mildred Sylvia, submitted by Margaret Blankenship. God's Garden. God looked around his garden and found an empty place. He then looked down upon the earth and saw your tired face. He put his arms around you and lifted you to rest. God's garden must be beautiful. He always takes the best. He knew that you were suffering. He knew that you were in pain. He knew that you would never get well on earth again. He saw the road was getting rough and the hills were hard to climb. So he closed your weary eyelids and whispered, "Peace be thine." It broke our hearts to lose you, but you did not go alone, for part of us went with you the day God called you home. Author D.W. McConway.
Hello, I am Kimber Robinson, a first-year student at West Virginia School of Osteopathic Medicine, and I am reading a tribute to Dallas Ware, submitted lovingly by his daughter, Brenda Scott. Dad was born on December 24, 1933. He liked to joke that he was born before baby Jesus. Putting it mildly, a joker, storyteller he was. Sometimes you couldn't help but believe him until we figured out different. Well then, the debate was on. Dad was a very hard worker to support his family. No job too small. As a plumber, he serviced so many customers and even big projects, like helping to build Greenbrier East High School in Lewisburg, West Virginia, and the nursing home in White Sulphur Springs, West Virginia. But he also was a very smart businessman as well. He owned and operated the skating rink at Hart's Run, West Virginia. He had so many fond memories from all the kids that came there. His hard work, his entire life paid off, and he traveled all over the United States. We were his usual company along on mostly all of his trips, and we all had a blast. Sometimes Dad took the scenic route, but eventually we made it to our destination. All of our childhood memories and adult memories we will treasure in our hearts forever. I could write a book about Dad and his life, and he would have gotten a kick out of that. I attribute everything I am is because of our Dad. So in closing, we thank you, Dad, for it all, for your advice, your doctoring skills, your spontaneous trips on Sunday, your inventions of different foods, your given support when needed, for raising all five kids to the best of your ability, for showing us there's a whole wide world to explore. But most of all, we thank the good Lord above for giving us you. We'll miss you endlessly and love you beyond. Thanks, Daddy-O. Dallas leaves behind three daughters and their spouses, Brenda Scott and husband Joey, Stephanie Bowling and husband Bob, and Bridget Cohenauer and husband Keith, daughter-in-law Carolyn Ware, four grandchildren, Joey Scott Jr., Melissa Scott Olzak, Ryan Callison, and Elena Cohenauer, 10 great-grandchildren, and one great-great-grandchild.
Hello, I am John Thomas, a first-year WVSOM student. Today, I have the privilege of sharing a tribute in honor of Scott Wilson, submitted by his sister, Barbara Angus. Our brother Scotty was an ornery but loving kid. In high school, he rowed for the Parkersburg High Crew team. After graduation in 1975, he went on to become a member of the Morris Harvey College Crew team. Scott enjoyed life, especially in his younger years. He got to travel with the crew team. He went deep sea fishing, whitewater rafting, and he even piggybacked off the New River Gorge Bridge on Bridge Day. Scott loved to fish, he loved to cook, and he loved to watch WVU games on TV. During his college days, Scott worked on the PA Denny Sternwheeler, and if he was here today, he would tell you that those were some of the best days of his life. He loved to go to the regattas, both in Charleston and Marietta. Over the years, he had become friends with many of the Sternwheelers, and he enjoyed visiting with them. In 2021, cancer had begun to take its toll on Scott, but he was able to make it to Marietta for one last visit with his friends. Scott's greatest joy was his son, Evan, who was so proud of him. He looked forward to his phone calls and occasional visits. Scott loved being around his family. A few years before he passed, he and his brothers took a week and went camping together. It was the first time and only time that they were able to get together, and they enjoyed some time together. Scott was many things to many people, but he was a friend to almost everyone he met. Scott was humble, he was kind, he was ornery, he was giving, he was such a devout WVU fan and a staunch Trump supporter. He loved to tell a good joke, and when his nieces and nephews came to visit, he enjoyed doing magic tricks for them. Scott had friends scattered all over the country, and he enjoyed spending time on Facebook with them. We are so thankful that a few years before he died, he was able to make a trip to Florida to spend some time with his friends Donnie Jelks and Skip Skit Sandberg. Shortly before he passed, some of his college friends were able to visit with him while he was in the hospital. Mike, Dave, and Tackin, you'll never know how happy he was to see you all after almost 42 years. Scott was proud of this country and actually gave up watching the NFL games when they started disrespecting our flag. Scott was giving, and even though his income was meager, I noticed when I went through his checkbooks that he still was able to make donations to St. Jude's Children's Hospital and the Wounded Warriors Association. My preacher visited Scott several weeks before his passing. They made small talk for a few minutes, and before Pastor had a chance to ask, Scott said, "I know why you are here, so I'll just save you the trouble of asking. I believe in Jesus Christ. I believe he was crucified, was dead, and buried. On the third day, he rose from the dead, and he ascended into heaven, and I'm going to be joining him shortly." Pastor gave him a thumbs up and said, "Sounds like you have all your T's crossed and your I's dotted." Our brother left this earth much too early. We will cherish his memories that he left us, and as time goes on, those memories will become treasure that we can fondly look back on. We miss you, Scott, but we know you're in a much better place, no more pain, no more suffering, and one day we will all see you again. Love you, brother.
Hello, my name is Claire Scheuer, and I am part of the WVSOM class of 2025. I have the privilege of reading tributes honoring Noel Wong, submitted with love by his family. The first by his wife Rima, followed by a remembrance and a poem written by his children, Mike, Greg, Pam, and Debbie. Noel is loved and missed by all. He was our confidant, our rock, our safe place. Great husband of 65 years. He was a father of four children, grandfather of 12, and great-grandfather of 17. He gave his all to his family with joy. It has been almost a year since he left us, but he is walking with us every day, and we feel his presence in all that we do. We are all continuing on, trying to live our lives to celebrate the life he lived. He enjoyed his garden, keeping his lawn in pristine condition. He also enjoyed bowling, fishing, and hunting, especially with his family. He will always be loved and missed, but we are so thankful for all the great memories we have with him. In memory of their father, submitted by Noel's children, Mike, Greg, Pam, and Debbie, the things my dad said would make me a better man were hard work and the love of friends. I hope our dad knows the seeds we've sown still grow. At night, I go to sleep and pray he is watching over us. Somewhere there's a star that's shining so bright that I can see you shine. One day we will never forget is the day we lost you. All that I need is one last chance just to hear you say goodbye. I hope you will always know the care that we built will always be with us. A poem honoring their dad. Dear God, we gratefully thank you for giving us our dad. You must really love us because you gave us the best you had. Watch over him and bless him, Lord, and keep him in your care. And may he feel our love for him is our humble, heartfelt prayer.